What's up everyone? Today's video is going to be a bit of an explainer, a bit of a rant, and a bit of a feature overview for these new X870 and X870E motherboards from AMD. Actually, they're from MSI, ASUS, and Gigabyte, but AMD is the one who determines the specs of the chipset, the launch date, and a bunch of other stuff about them. And honestly, I think AMD has done its board partners a bit dirty this time around.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by the Paul's Hardware store on paulshardware.net, the only official source for Paul's Hardware merchandise, tantalizing t-shirts, brilliant beer sets, high-quality hoodies, and more, all featuring the classic thumbscrew for tasteful and refined viewers, or the 8-bit thumbscrew for tasteful and refined viewers who hate curves. New designs are added sporadically and at random, so head over to paulshardware.net and get some of that sweet, sweet merch right now. Or not right now, after you watch the video. Either way. So why do I think AMD has treated its board partners a bit unkindly this time around? Well, typically new motherboards get sold along with a CPU. That's not universal, of course, but it is much more typical. So that's why you'll often see an entire new platform launch all at once, because it encourages people who are interested to buy an entire new setup, the CPU, the motherboard, often memory as well. And according to early rumors, X870 and X870E motherboards were not going to launch by themselves. They were going to launch alongside a 9800X3D CPU, but that CPU is currently nowhere to be found, and we're not really sure if it's going to launch anytime soon. So that puts a bit of a damper on the excitement for this launch, and that's not to say there aren't new 9000 series CPUs that will slot into these motherboards. Ryzen 9000 series launched last month. Unfortunately, the uptake has not been that great so far. So strike one, we have no new 9800X3D CPU, and the 9000 series CPUs that just launched are not that tantalizing to customers. Strike two, people who are about to build a system and are looking at AM5 might be looking at the 7800X3D, and that is also horribly priced right now. It's gone from $330 to $350 all the way up to unavailable anywhere for less than $525 or so. Some god-awful third-party seller over on Newegg is trying to sell it for $690 and tell you it's a sale? I hate awful third-party sellers. I just do. Strike three, though, it's not a new chipset. It's the same chipset as X670. Let me show you. Over here on AMD's Socket AM5 chipsets handy guide, you'll note how many Socket AM5 chipsets there are. Too many, in my opinion. AMD, you have too many chipsets. It's too confusing. You'll note on the top here, we have X870E and X870. That just launched. They're also gonna be coming out with B850 and B840 motherboards, but we're not expecting those until January. Probably we'll see them at CES. But you still have the 600 series chipsets, X670E, X670, the very popular B650. Those all still exist. They are compatible with Ryzen 9000 series CPUs with a BIOS update. They will maintain compatibility with the X3D CPUs once those launch as well. And in my opinion, the biggest argument against these new motherboards, X870 in particular, is the existence of the last gen chipsets. I'm referencing an Angstronomics article from 2022 to show you guys how the Promontory 21 chipsets are configured. So here's a basic block diagram of the B650 chipset configuration. It's a single chip, and that uses one Promontory 21 chip, and that connects to the CPU via a PCI Express 4.0x4 connection. The chipset enables a bunch of additional connectivity, more PCI Express lanes, more SATA, USB 3.2, as well as USB ports, but it's also operating as a bit of a switch because you have lots of devices potentially connected to a single x4 lane. For X670 and X670E, you have two Promontory 21 chipsets that are daisy chained together. They use four of the PCI Express lanes from the first chip to connect up the second chip, enabling a bunch of additional I/O. And that's a value add. People might pay more money for an X670 or X670E motherboard to get more connectivity because they know in the future they're going to need to connect a lot of devices or add-on cards to their system. This means if you compare B650 connectivity, specifically the USB and the SATA, to X670, everything doubles, almost. Going from 6 to 12 10 gigabit USB ports, for example, or going from 4 to 8 SATA ports. My big complaint about X870, though, is that it uses a single Promontory 21 chip configuration, just like B650 did. And call me a little crazy, but I feel like if they're going with the same chip configuration, upgrading the name but not upgrading the chip configuration seems a little bit disingenuous to me. That said, if you go all the way up to X870E, you do get a two Promontory 21 chip configuration, so you have essentially the same I/O that you get with X670E In terms of raw baseline spec advantages, AMD has only made us two real promises with X870 and X870E. One is that USB 4.0 is now standard, but it doesn't come baked in. It's basically an additional USB 4.0 add-on chip that ships to the motherboard manufacturers along with the chipset chips. And that means that, yes, there are already existing X670 and X670E motherboards that have added on a USB 4.0 chip, so you can find 600 series boards that do have that feature. And you can see that USB 4.0 controller as an add-on chip in the block diagrams for X870E and X870 directly from AMD. The only other advantage that AMD is promising is DDR5 8000 Expo memory kits. And they should be slightly more easy to turn on and get functional with an 800 series motherboard. But again, this is something that plenty of mid-range to high-end 600 series motherboards have already been capable of. So hopefully that gives you a better explanation of the differences from the 600 series going up to the 800 series. And let's see if my frustration is warranted by taking a look at actual prices. Just jumping over here to Newegg, where they have a landing page set up for the new X870 motherboards. Starting off with combos, of course, to obfuscate the pricing of the actual motherboards just a little bit. Aha, here they are, and they have chosen to feature all X870E motherboards, at least on this landing page. So if you guys follow my build guides, you know that I like to find the budget darling motherboard for any given platform. For AM5, my go-to recommendation recently has been the V650PG Lightning from ASRock. There's actually a couple different variants of this board. It's $150, and if you build an AM5 system with this motherboard and get it up and running, you probably will forget what motherboard you're using a month or two down the line. And it will function just as well as any $200, $300, or $500 plus AM5 board. So with $150 established as our baseline, how much more would you have to pay if you wanted to upgrade to X870? The answer, at least at launch, is about $200. We'll use Newegg's actual filters, and we can see here, big surprise, ASRock is also coming in with the least expensive X870 boards with their Pro Series. Why is it listed three times? I don't know. If you want to go non-ASRock, Gigabyte has a model for $220, MSI has the $240 X870-P, and ASUS is coming in at $250 with the Prime X870-P. So for everyone out there who doesn't see much value in running DDR5 8000 speed memory, we're looking at a $50 plus premium here for essentially USB 4.0 support. And I did also pull up B650 chipset motherboards over here on Newegg because they do get pretty inexpensive. There are options for $130 to $150, but again, the ASRock PG Lightning or the garishly decorated Live Mixer, which is the same board just with a hideous color scheme, are both available for $150. But what if you do actually want the additional connectivity provided by a chipset solution with two Promontory 21 chips? For that, you could go X670 or X670E, or you could go X870E. So looking at the cheapest X670 and X670E motherboards on Newegg, and actually there's an ASRock X670E for $200. But yeah, about $200, which is the same price as the X870 chips. But again, on the 600 series, these will both have two Promontory 21 chips, so you'll get all that additional connectivity. So here again is where I would advise builders to look if you're building an AM5 system and you don't want to pay an exorbitant amount of money for a motherboard that's not going to do much more for you in terms of connectivity or performance. So about $200 to $250 is the entry level starting point for the X670 and X670E motherboards, whereas the cheapest X870E motherboard currently at launch is $320 with the Gigabyte X670E Aorus Elite. But it ramps up from there pretty quickly. Another Gigabyte board for $360, and then we get into the $500 range. So at this point, if we consider the pricing and the performance advantages or potentially lack thereof for the 800 series, it becomes pretty evident that AMD is again its own worst enemy, and the 600 series motherboards are really offering a lot more value for the dollar. All right, I would be remiss if I did not show you these motherboards that I have, so I'm going to be going over the features and showing you a closer look at each one. I went to each of the motherboard manufacturers that I work with regularly, ASUS, MSI, and Gigabyte, and I said, in my mind, I have three tiers of motherboards, the entry level, the budget option, the gets the job done for the lowest price possible, like the $150 ASRock board. I have a step up from there, spend maybe $50 to $100 more, get yourself some added features that are actually gonna benefit you and you're gonna make use of. That's kind of my mid-tier board. And of course, we also have the Halo boards, the price is no object option. The hey motherboard manufacturers throw every bell and whistle you possibly can at a motherboard and then probably charge $1,000 plus for it. To that end, here are the boards I ended up with. From Gigabyte, we have the X870E Aorus Masters. This is a $500 MSRP motherboard, and I believe it's the top-end motherboard that Gigabyte is currently coming out with. They might come out with something else further down the line, but this definitely fits more towards the Halo tier category. Then I have a couple X870 boards, the MAG X870 Tomahawk Wi-Fi. This one has a $300 MSRP, although it does have a $10 mail-in rebate as well right now. I asked MSI if they remembered when their OG Tomahawk motherboards cost like $110 or $115. Remember that? And then from Asus, we have the TUF Gaming X870 Plus Wi-Fi. This one's currently selling for $310. So both of these boards would fall into the budget plus category. Obviously, we don't have anything that's down towards the $200 range right now. But honestly, if I haven't made it clear already, if you're looking for a budget build or you're trying to save money, you probably shouldn't be going for the 800 series. You should probably go for B650 or X670. Let's start off with the X870E Aorus Master from Gigabyte for a quick unboxing and overview, because this was the first one that arrived to me. Showing you guys these in the order I received them. Here's a look at the accessories that come in the box. We've entered the age of not receiving a full manual for motherboards. They have a QR code that lets you access that online. We got a case badge, we got some cable ties, we got their G connector, we have some temperature sensors, SATA cable, an active fan that you can add to the chipset if you want, and a Wi-Fi antenna because this board, like many of the newer boards, has Wi-Fi 7 support. Here is the Aorus Master motherboard itself. This has a similar design aesthetic to their 600 series Aorus Master motherboard. So just to run down some of the highlights for this motherboard, we have a very large heatsink area over here. This does have an RGB panel on top of it. It's going to display the Aorus Eagle logo in RGB. It is a 16+2+2 phase VRM solution, so this should be perfectly adequate for overclocking, especially up to a 9950X. Some useful tools up here on the top right and a debug LED, as well as a surface mounted power and reset button. Interestingly, there's an HDMI port over here on this side. I guess that's just for ease of use for overclockers who are doing an open testbed setup. A quick correction, this fan that's included in the accessories is actually called the DDR5 Wind Blade. It's included to provide additional airflow over your DDR5 memory, especially if you're going to be overclocking that to high speeds, and especially if you're going to be using something like an all-in-one liquid cooler to provide additional airflow around the socket is never a bad thing. We also have multiple fan headers scattered throughout the board. We have four RGB LED headers. Three of them are 5-volt and one of them is 12-volt. And as for M.2 connectivity, we have easy latch support for all of them. This top slot here is PCIe Gen 5 compatible if you're using a Ryzen 9000 series processor. And being a Gen 5 slot, it has a really large heat sink to go on top of that. We also have an easy latch to remove this bottom cover here for access to three more M.2 slots. And Gigabyte has conveniently labeled the Gen 5 compatible ports with Gen 5. There's two more Gen 5 M.2s down here directly connected to the CPU and one Gen 4 M.2 that goes through the chipset. And finally, here's a look at the rear I/O. They have an easy connector set up for your Wi-Fi 7 antenna, as well as convenient external clear CMOS and Q-flash buttons, lots of USB 3.2 ports, and of course those two USB Type-C ports that are USB 4.0 compatible. The listing for the X870E Aorus Master is already up on Newegg. You can see it's $500. There's only one other key feature of this board that I wanted to point out to you guys. If I scroll down a little bit here on their landing page. Ah yes, it's the Aorus AI Snatch. It's an AI-powered overclock. It's not just an excellent movie by Guy Ritchie and a bawdy euphemism, it's also the name that Gigabyte has chosen for their automatic DDR5 memory boost and one-click overclocking feature for their motherboard. So if you guys have any feedback for Gigabyte on their new Aorus AI Snatch feature, let us know about that in the comments below. Next, the Asus TUF Gaming X870 Plus Wi-Fi. This one also features Wi-Fi 7, as well as premium accessories like an actual manual. It's black and white, but at least you don't have to go online for it. You get a set of stickers too, some SATA cables, like a little screw and some rubber tabs probably to cover some of the ports, and of course that Wi-Fi 7 antenna. Here is the motherboard itself. Did you notice that this is a TUF board? This is a TUF series board, anyone who wasn't aware. Now I will say that one of the first things manufacturers seem to invest in when the board prices start to go up and they have a little bit more to work with in terms of BOM cost is they tend to go at the VRMs and beef those up and make sure that they're capable of running the top-end CPU on the platform, which is currently the 9950X or the 7950X. The benefit here is that even if you're not overclocking, VRM temperatures tend to be lower with boards that have overbuilt power delivery as well as lots of large heat sinks to absorb the heat and wick it away. Overall layout's going to be similar with most AM5 boards, of course. Got the AM5 socket, four DDR5 slots here for memory expansion. Again, plenty of connectivity for fans. as well as 1, 2, 3, 5-volt addressable RGB LED headers. The power delivery configuration on this board is 16 plus 2 plus 1, which can handle up to 80 amps. And then for the M.2 layout, we have 1, 2, 3, 4 slots once again. Difference this time is that the top two on this board are PCIe 5.0 compatible, and we have two lower ones that are PCIe Gen 4 compatible. And on this board, we don't have easy remove latches. We do need to use a screwdriver. And you do get a small heatsink for that top slot. For the I/O, we have an externally accessible BIOS flashback button that is very convenient. Your Wi-Fi 7 antenna connection points, a mix of 5 gigabit and 10 gigabit USB ports, and I appreciate that those are labeled with the speeds that they're capable of. You also have a 2.5 gig Ethernet port, and again, those two 40 gigabit per second USB 4.0 ports. And also, one of my favorite new motherboard trends is a release latch for the top slot for your graphics card. This tough one does have one that's accessible, a slightly new design. And since I didn't mention it, the Gigabyte Aorus board has one of these as well. Our last board to look at today is the MSI MAG or MAG X870 Tomahawk Wi-Fi. For accessories, once again, no manual, but we do have a quick installation guide. Here's a little bribe for a product review, and they'll enter you in a giveaway. And hey, if you're gonna have stickers that ship along with a motherboard, I appreciate the actual practical use of some of these, being able to label your cables, fan plugs, RGB stuff. And you know, you got some Lucky Dragon stickers there too, that's appreciated. Beyond that, Wi-Fi 7 antenna, of course, SATA cables, some additional connectors here for M.2 drives, and some breakouts connectors for RGB. And look, a USB drive. I'm gonna assume that this has drivers and stuff on it. Ever since they stopped including a CD in the box with motherboards, I assumed they were gonna switch over to including little USB sticks, but that almost never happens. I do appreciate when it's included though. I'm gonna plug this in right now and see if it actually has drivers on it. This is an early sample, so it's possible that they might load that up with drivers in the future. It is a 24 gig drive, 23.5 gig. I take that back. All right, it has a CD image, so there is drivers on it in the form of a CD image, and it's a 32 gig drive, so you actually get some storage. If you double click this, it will auto run, but we can see by opening it that, look, they've included drivers. Yay, thank you, MSI, I appreciate that. Having a driver disk or USB like that is most useful when you first set up your system and you need to access the internet, but Windows doesn't automatically identify and set up the Wi-Fi or networking devices that you have on the board. But here's our Tomahawk board, and I have mixed feelings about the aesthetics on this one. On the one hand, the black and sort of neon yellow reminded me immediately of some rollerblades that I used to have back when I was a lot younger than I am now. So that may or may not be your thing. I don't think it's too bad, but I do like the finish on all the heat sinks and everything here. It's very uniform, very clean looking, and it's that sort of subtly textured metal that didn't have to have pieces of plastic covering it everywhere that you peel off. Those heat sinks, of course, are providing some heat dissipation for our power delivery. This board has a 14 plus 2 plus 1 power delivery setup. Moving on from there, next to our four DDR5 slots, we have a debug LED. That's a great thing to have included. It's especially useful if you're just getting your system set up and you have any issues that you're trying to debug. We once again have a quick release latch for our top PCI Express slot. The MSI one is actually sort of an on-off button, and it actually has a little label in there that tells you whether it's locked or unlocked. Again, we have plenty of fan headers across the board, so that's not an issue. Again, we have 1, 2, 3, 5-volt addressable RGB LED headers. And our M.2 configuration is once again split with two 5.0 M.2 slots. These do have a pretty easy to remove latch mechanism. So these two with the heat sinks are PCIe 5.0. And then there's two more under here that don't have a quick release, and those are USB 4.0. And finally, for rear I/O on the fixed I/O shield, which all these boards have, by the way, that's become pretty standard. I would be very upset if any of these boards didn't have a fixed I/O shield. But we have external flash BIOS and clear CMOS buttons, three 5 gigabit USB 3.0 ports, three 10 gigabit USB 3 ports, with one of those being a Type C. Four USB 2.0 ports, which is good for connecting peripherals, but they're not gonna have a ton of bandwidth. Of course, those two requisite 40 gigabit USB-C ports, a 5 gigabit Ethernet jack, and your Wi-Fi 7 connectors. So that is my explainer for X870 and X870E motherboards that have just launched. There's a lot more boards than just the ones I've shown you guys today out on the market, but I'll post links to these down in the video's description. And I hope this video has helped you guys get a better understanding of what X870 can and can't do, especially the difference between X870 and X870E. And what the heck, I'll post some links to some 600 series motherboards down in the description too, in case you're looking for a little bit better deal than these 800 series boards that just launched. Once again, thank you for watching this video, and if you enjoyed it, hit the thumbs up button. Maybe consider subscribing to my YouTube channel so you can see more videos like this when they come out. And of course, check out my store at pulsehardware.net, where I have high quality merchandise, shirts, mugs, pint glasses, new desk mats, and more. Thanks again for watching, guys, and we'll see you all in the next one.